When the richest man in the world, Elon Musk, bought Twitter, the company was thrown into chaos.
I'm looking for something that's, like I said, broadly inclusive as possible, that's as trusted as possible as a system, and I hope we are successful in that regard.
So the social media platform's employees are due to find any minute now whether they still have a job.
I try to log in, and my email is just not working anymore. And that's when I knew that I had been laid off.
It's not so much the concern of, you know, the hellscape right now, it's the chaos.
Elon Musk says that he will begin restoring previously banned Twitter accounts.
For the past few months, I've been investigating what that chaos means for people that use Twitter. Current and former employees have been telling me their concerns that, under Musk's leadership, the social media site can no longer protect users from trolls and other harmful content. When I published my report, I caught Musk's attention. He tweeted, "Sorry for turning Twitter from nurturing paradise into place that has trolls." And, have to admit, trolls are kind of fun. And it wasn't just his attention I caught. An army of troll accounts joined in and a deluge of hate came my way. And it's not just me who's received more abuse since the Twitter takeover. I'm Mariana Spring, the BBC's disinformation and social media correspondent. And this is Trolled from BBC Trending. In this series, we're investigating how people are targeted and abused on social media and who's behind the trolling, from Myanmar to Brazil. But first, we're looking at Twitter itself and how after the richest person in the world bought the company, hate is thriving. The trolls are back. As a journalist, I'm on Twitter a lot. It's a vital tool for me to share my work and connect with people who are affected by disinformation, conspiracies, and online hate. I'm used to getting abuse on the platform, and funnily enough, it's my own online abuse that got me looking into this in the first place. I noticed I wasn't receiving as much online hate on Twitter as usual throughout last year, 2022. But then it took a turn for the worse following Musk's takeover. And it wasn't just me who noticed more hate on the site.
So I posted a tweet on the 3rd of January, 2023, and it reads, "In the early hours of New Year's Day 2018, I was raped while unconscious by someone I trusted. This was the beginning of a cycle of abuse that lasted years."
Ellie Wilson started campaigning on Twitter about violence against women last summer, after the man who raped her was convicted and later sentenced to 5 years in prison. At first, the response to her activism was positive.
I think that I would have been more apprehensive if I'd thought, you know, that there was a possibility of me receiving hatred online.
But then, in January of this year, something changed.
All of a sudden, these trolls appeared.
She received an onslaught of hateful posts, a wave of horrific messages with abusive language and misogynistic slurs.
"Someone is after celeb status."
"Sorry, I don't believe this girl one bit."
"Revels in the attention."
"You deserve it. I'm not a hater. I'm just stating the obvious."
And those are some of the milder ones that we can read out.
When I saw the first hateful comment, I just felt like my stomach just and my heart just drop. Like, you hear about this happening online, but it's quite something to then experience it personally because I've never had that before. It was heartbreaking, to be honest. I find it most difficult, the people that say that I wasn't raped or that this didn't happen and that I'm lying. But also it's sort of like a secondary trauma.
The period in which my online hate seemed to get worse mirrored what Ellie experienced too. So I set out to find out whether there really was more abuse on Twitter, and if so, why?
I'm Dr. Julie Pizzetti. I'm a researcher and a journalist. I lead research at the International Centre for Journalists.
Julie has been investigating online violence against female journalists, including myself, for 3.5 years.
In the course of this work, we've looked at around 18 million social media posts.
Julie reviewed the abuse I received across 3 periods. The first in spring of 2021, the second in early 2022, and the third once Elon Musk had taken over later that year. She did find the abuse I received had lessened before that takeover.
We can see that the abuse against you has dramatically declined by something like 45 times. And what's really interesting about that is that in the intervening period, we know that Twitter had started to introduce policies designed to protect people who were being targeted prolifically, like you, specifically people who were journalists and human rights defenders, for example, who were being targeted because of their work.
But then, under Musk's leadership, the abuse noticeably increased.
The abuse against you has more than tripled. And that's according to what our tools determine to be obvious abuse. So it's quite possible that the uptick has been much more extreme than that, but that's what we can see for now.
We can't know for certain why abuse targeting me or Ellie suddenly got worse. And it's important to note Ellie's Twitter following was smaller back when she was receiving less hate. But Julie does have some ideas.
I mean, the logical conclusion is that we are detecting more abuse because there is more abuse, and there is more abuse because A, some of the abusive accounts have been reinstated or allowed to proliferate. B, the tools and the mechanisms and the teams that were focused on monitoring cases of abuse towards you and towards women journalists in general, because this has been a special focus on women journalists, but particularly emblematic cases like yours, the fact that you're starting to see this increase points to the decline and failure of those systems that were being built up.
When Elon Musk bought Twitter in October, he had two clear priorities: to make the social media company profitable and to champion freedom of expression. And he's taken strong action to enact his vision. Since the takeover, over half of Twitter's workforce have been sacked or chosen to leave, and thousands of previously banned accounts have been allowed back onto the platform. And when I looked into the accounts targeting Ellie, some of them had become more active since Musk's takeover, suggesting they'd been suspended previously and recently reinstated. Others were newly created.
Why are these accounts that are bullying and harassing people still allowed on the platform? I don't really feel protected by Twitter, and I think that I've reported things on Twitter in the past and nothing has come of it. So I don't really have much faith in the platform for actually taking these things seriously.
I travelled to sunny San Francisco, the home of Twitter's headquarters, to hear from the insiders who worked there.
Hello. Hi. Lovely to meet you.
It's so nice to meet you.
Thanks so much for having us.
Twitter, from the very beginning, was about freedom of expression, right? Our founders really strongly believed in it. The idea that everyone, everywhere deserves to be heard.
That's Lisa Jennings Young. She was the head of content design and started at Twitter in 2019, working there for 4 years on features designed to protect users, like Ellie and I, from online hate. Lisa acknowledges some of the concerns Musk had around moderation on the platform, and that abuse was always a problem on Twitter.
You know, the idea of absolute free speech doesn't exist, because when one person can shut down a lot of people from having that right as well. So we realize there's trade-offs between that safety, privacy, and free speech. It was not at all perfect, but we were trying and we were making things better, you know, all the time, you know, working as hard as we could.
Lisa worked on various protective measures that include safety mode, which aims to automatically block abusive accounts, and another called the nudge function, to scan tweets and ask users if they want to reconsider posting something potentially abusive. Twitter's own research, seen by the BBC, appears to show the nudge and other safety tools being effective.
So it really blew us away. 31% of people edited or deleted their replies when given a chance via the nudge. So that's 31% of people chose to edit or delete when presented with this nudge. And that's really, really significant.
These safety features were being implemented around the period when my abuse on Twitter seemed to decrease, according to Julie's data. It's impossible to directly correlate the two, but given what Lisa tells me about how effective the measures appeared to be, it seems possible to draw a link. I asked Lisa whether there's still a team working on features like this at Twitter.
No, there's no one there to work on that at this time. Yeah. The design org, design and research, we had over 200 people, and, you know, there's just a few people left, product designers, but no content designers left.
Given that Lisa's team has been drastically cut, I wanted to see whether the harmful reply nudge was still working. So we conducted a little experiment.
Let's test out the harmful reply nudge.
Okay.
I've got this account, which is a dummy account. It's totally private. It doesn't have any followers or friends.
Okay.
And you've agreed that we can tweet at you.
You can, yeah.
What would normally trigger that harmful reply nudge?
Yeah. Let's try something like Twitter employees are lazy losers, you know, jump off the Golden Gate Bridge and die.
Okay. No nudge.
Interesting.
When we sent a tweet that included a swear word, the nudge did appear. But Lisa said it should work on more than just that. Our experiment does show that the feature appears to be working less consistently. And when I spoke to an engineer still at Twitter, they confirmed to me that there was no one taking care of features like this, and that the social media site was like a building where all the pieces are on fire. This isn't just about hate coming from a handful of trolls. It can be state-sponsored and coordinated. I spoke to staff from Twitter who work to tackle harassment campaigns like this, often targeting journalists, dissidents and activists in countries without the media freedom we have in the UK.
The most prominent examples of influence operations that a lot of people have probably heard about are the 2016 operation by Russia's Internet Research Agency to influence the 2016 elections in the US, all the way to the Myanmar military's influence operation, which was waged against the Rohingya in Myanmar.
That's Ray. His team was in charge of identifying, assessing, and shutting down malicious state-sponsored influence operations.
I think one of the things that's central to an influence operation is the use of fake accounts or inauthentic accounts. So accounts which purport often to be someone or a group of people located somewhere when in fact they're not.
Once an influence operation had been identified, the accounts involved would be suspended or the visibility of their posts would be reduced. Twitter had invested in teams to tackle this type of manipulation on the platform.
We were about 24 in total, which included policy folks all the way to, you know, investigators that were doing technical investigations to really data-heavy folks. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that that team did that work daily, either the disruption of accounts, fake accounts, inauthentic accounts, and attribution of them. Yeah, I would say every couple of weeks that was taking place.
After Musk took over, key members of staff involved in tackling these influence operations were laid off. What does this mean for Twitter?
Twitter might have been the refuge where, you know, a journalist could go out and have their voice be heard and be critical of the government, but I'm not sure that's going to be the case anymore.
Unlike many of their colleagues, neither Ray nor Lisa were made redundant from Twitter after Musk took over. But they decided they could no longer work at the company under his leadership.
I spent a lot of my career protecting the civil and political rights of folks around the world. Working in an NGO for something like 6 years, going to the UN to work on human rights investigations, and then ending up at Twitter, where I thought, you know, my background, my working experiences, working in like places like Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Syria, Palestine, could be useful. And I wasn't sure that the new Twitter cared about any of those things anymore.
I wanted to ask Elon Musk about his vision for Twitter and whether he had any response to revelations made by current and former Twitter employees, including Ray and Lisa. I reached out to him via email and message, and even used an eye-catching but unscientific Twitter vote to catch his attention. But there was no reply from Musk, and no response from Twitter to the points raised in the investigation. I'd been told that all of Twitter's communications team have either resigned or been sacked. But then, when the investigation went live online, it did elicit that series of tweets from Musk. "Sorry for turning Twitter from nurturing paradise into place that has trolls," he said in one, posting a screen grab of the report. According to Twitter's own data, that tweet was seen by over 30 million Twitter profiles. "Trolls are kind of fun," he said in another. The investigation made clear Twitter was never perfect. "I've spent the last few years exposing how trolling affects people on Twitter and other social media platforms. But what it did highlight is how hate has worsened and how, under Musk, insiders think Twitter is no longer capable of protecting users against trolls. True to that, after Musk's tweet came a torrent of abuse against me from other users. From posts with misogynistic slurs and abusive language, to threatening messages, including depicting kidnap and hanging. When Musk said "Ruffle MAO," rolling on the floor laughing my ass off, in response to a tweet making light of the investigation, I wasn't rolling on the floor laughing. I was wading through abusive messages sent from accounts predominantly based in the US and the UK. Many seemed to have been reinstated. Some were prominent conspiracy theorists and right-wing profiles brought back under Musk's amnesty on suspended accounts. Several had the new paid-for blue ticks. The way this unfolded confirmed what I'd already uncovered. I approached Twitter and Musk again. They've not responded. A lot of the trolls getting in touch with me said the same thing. Don't stick around then. Leave Twitter if the hate is so bad. And that invites a bigger question. If the company is falling apart and you're targeted by hate, why keep using the platform? Is Twitter still relevant? Here's what Ray had to say.
So much of the world's media is on Twitter. Governments are on Twitter, right? Heads of state are on Twitter. And I would say opinion makers are on Twitter. There are second order effects which filter down into like all the media we consume, into like popular culture. So I think it's really important for that reason. And it's really important to understand, right? When opinion is being made, like when the sausage is being made, who's making it? How are they doing it?
It's a place I want to keep using, but I'm well aware of the risks that come with that. Julie was concerned over the potentially grave consequences of allowing hate to proliferate on Twitter.
When the person who now owns the platform signals, it's okay, mate, say what you like, we're more tolerant of that kind of thing now, which is what we've heard, that's an entreaty to do and say what you want, and to do so with impunity. And that's one of the things that really concerns us, because attacks on journalists, crimes against journalists, including murder with impunity, are a serious problem, and we know that there are connections with the online violence that they experience and the threats that they experience before arguably more egregious physical assaults occur.
As for Ellie, she still sees the positives of the platform.
It's a way for me to process my trauma. I've managed to build a community around this, and it helps me and others feel less alone. And I think it also makes me feel a lot better knowing that I can maybe make things a little bit better for other people and that I can raise awareness. I don't think that I should have to silence myself just to, you know, avoid the ire of a small subset of angry and, in my opinion, pathetic people.
Ellie isn't planning to stop campaigning on the site anytime soon, despite the online hate she receives. Twitter says defending and protecting the user's voice is still a key value. But the storm of abuse on Twitter continues. That's it for this edition of BBC Trending's Trolled series, with me, Mariana Spring. A huge thanks to producers Beth Godwin and Olivia Lace-Evans and Hal Haynes for mixing this episode. If you want to get in touch about this episode, then you can do so by emailing me at mariana.spring@bbc.co.uk. We're also on Facebook and Twitter. Just search for BBC Trending and follow us. And remember to leave us a rating or a review, wherever you get your podcasts from.